Welcome to another edition of the Efficient eLearning SAP Training Series. This video is SAP Accounts Payable, Transaction FB60, Post-Vendor Invoice. And here's a list of our topics. First up, we'll confirm where transaction code FB60 fits in the procure-to-pay process, followed by an explanation of the difference between a non-PO invoice and an invoice referencing a purchase order. Then it's on to the practical component of the video, posting a non-PO invoice using transaction FB60 in SAP. Once the invoice is posted, we'll then analyse the vendor line item display, transaction FBL1N. Let's begin with where transaction FB60 fits in the procure-to-pay process. It's worth noting at this point that a non-PO invoice does not reference a purchase order, so the procurement steps in the procure-to-pay process, create purchase requisition, approve purchase requisition, convert requisition to purchase order, and post goods receipt are not relevant. Transaction FB60 sits within the post-vendor invoice step and is completed by the accounts payable department. Okay, so we've established where transaction FB60 fits in the procure-to-pay process. Now let's discuss the difference between a non-PO invoice and an invoice referencing a purchase order. Here's the two documents side by side. Visually, the only real difference is the purchase order field. As you would expect, for a non-PO invoice this field is blank. Conversely, for an invoice referencing a purchase order, the field is populated with the relevant purchase order number. So why do some invoices reference a purchase order and others don't? Some organizations have a strict policy. All invoices must reference a purchase order or they cannot be processed. But typically, most organizations will require the majority of invoices to reference a purchase order, with some limited exceptions. In this fictitious company example, invoices for mobile phone plan costs are a permitted exception. That is, invoices don't require a purchase order. However, the purchase of mobile phone handsets still requires a purchase order. In this video, the focus is on posting a non-PO invoice, so we can discard the invoice referencing a purchase order. Now that we have our invoice, we can process it in SAP using transaction FB60. When processing accounts payable invoices, I tend to display the invoice on the left and the SAP screen to the right. If you're new to SAP, it's worth noting where transaction FB60 resides in the SAP standard menu. Start with the accounting folder, then financial accounting, accounts payable, and document entry. Now you can simply double click on this entry to open the transaction. However, as I'm going to be using this transaction frequently, I'll create a favorite for the transaction. To create a favorite for the transaction, right click on the entry and choose Add to Favorites. I'm not happy with the standard description for the favorite, so I'll right-click on the entry and choose Change Favorite. I can now change the description. I'll rename the entry Post Non-PO Invoice and then click Continue. I can now double-click on this favorite to open the transaction. Always make note of the company code. If the company code is not correct, you can switch company code using this button on the application toolbar. In this example, the company code is correct, so there's no need to change it. The first field we need to populate is the vendor field. If you know the vendor code, you can simply type it in this field. However, most users won't know the vendor code and will have to search for the vendor. Click in the vendor field and click the drop-down list to the right. This displays the match codes or search helps for the vendor field. The simplest way to find a vendor is to search using the name field. For example, if we type XYZ asterisk in the name field and then click the Start Search button, the desired vendor, XYZ Mobile, is listed in the search results. I can now double-click on the vendor code to select it. Next up is the invoice date field. This is the date on the vendor invoice. Click in the invoice date field and enter the date referenced on the invoice. The reference field is the vendor's invoice number. Click in the reference field and type in the invoice number from the invoice. The posting date is pre-populated with the current date. Normally this date isn't changed unless you're given specific instructions by the accounting department. For example, sometimes at month end an instruction is given to use the last date for the prior month until the prior period is closed. In this example, we'll simply leave it as the default. The amount field represents the gross amount of the invoice, so the net amount plus tax. Click in the amount field and type in the total value from the invoice. The tax amount field is the total tax value for the invoice. Again, click in the tax amount field and type in the value from the invoice. To the right of the tax amount field is the tax code field at invoice header level. If all of the lines on the invoice have the same tax code, you can enter that tax code in this field, and it will default to this value on all of the invoice line items below. However, if not all of the line items have the same tax code, it is best to leave this tax code field at invoice header level blank. In our example, there's only one line item, so we can input the tax code in this field. Based on the values on the invoice and experience of this type of purchase, the tax code should be P1, GST 10%. Now press the Enter key on the keyboard to validate the information entered. Note the warning message at the bottom of the screen indicating the invoice is overdue. Press Enter again to bypass the warning message. The invoice header details are now complete. We can now move on to the invoice line items. This is where we enter the account assignment details for the invoice. In this example, a cost center and a general ledger account. Click in the GL account field. Again, if you know the GL account code, you can simply enter it manually here. However, in this example, we'll assume we have to search for the codes. Click the drop-down list to the right of the field. In the GL long text field, type TEL asterisk and click the Start Search button. Double-click on the GL account for telephone rental. Now click in the amount field and enter the net amount for the line item excluding tax. And finally, click in the cost center field and click the drop-down list to the right. In the Cost Center short text field, type admin asterisk and then click the Start Search button. Double-click on the Administration Cost Center. Now press the Enter key on the keyboard to validate the entered values. As the balance of the invoice is zero, and there are no error messages, we can now click the Post button to post the vendor invoice. Note the message at the bottom of the screen with the invoice number. Now the invoice has been posted, we can view it on the vendor line item display, transaction FBL1N. Let's now go to the folder where transaction FBL1N resides in the SAP standard menu. Start with the accounting folder, then choose financial accounting, accounts payable, and account. Again, you can simply double-click on this entry to open the transaction. However, I'm going to right-click on the entry and choose Add to Favorites. Like the previous favorite, I'm not happy with the standard description, so I'll right-click on the entry and choose Change Favorite. I can now change the description. I'll rename the entry Vendor Line Item Report and click Continue. I can now double-click on this favorite to open the transaction. Some values have defaulted into the Vendor Account and Company Code fields. The company code is correct, but I'm not sure of the vendor code, so I'll click the drop-down list and search for the vendor once again. Click in the name field, type XYZ asterisk, and click the Start Search button. Double-click on the desired entry. We can now choose the line item selection. There are three choices: open items, cleared items, and all items. I'd like to see everything, so I'm going to choose all items. And in the type section, I'm simply going to leave it as the default value, normal items. I can now click the Execute button to run the report. As you can see, the document number that we posted previously in transaction FB60 now appears in this report. So let's note some of the other fields in the report and explain their meaning. This red status symbol means that it's an open item. That means the invoice has been posted, but it hasn't yet been paid. The document type is KR. This is the standard document type for invoices posted via transaction FB60. The reference number and the document date are the invoice number and invoice date from the vendor invoice. The posting date was selected when we posted the invoice in transaction FB60. The payment terms come from the vendor master record. These payment terms represent net 30 days. So the invoice is due for payment 30 days after the document date. And as you can see, this is reflected in the net due date. This is the net due date symbol, and as you can see, the invoice is overdue. And the arrears after net due date field shows how many days the invoice is in arrears. So the invoice has been due for payment for 10 days now. We'll only touch briefly on the functionality within this report. Later on in the video series, we'll have a dedicated video just for this transaction, and in that video we'll go into the functionality in much more depth. We've now covered all of the content for this video. Remember to give it a like and subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new videos are uploaded. Thanks for watching.